Ok.
Okay, so good afternoon to everybody. It's a great pleasure for me having the opportunity to introduce and discuss with Luca Del Monte about space economy and ESA industrial policy. Luca is the head of the industrial policy and the SME division of the European Space Agency, and in fact, his division advised ESA member state about the development of a global competitive and sustainable space industry, able to foster the European space economy and so to sustain the growth of a new generation of European space entrepreneurs. Luca has also been in charge of the development of several security-related space projects, including, for instance, the Space Situational Awareness and the fifth European Space Security Center. Prior to joining ESA, Luca has held several technical managerial responsibilities within the Italian Space Agency, ASI, the European Patent Office, and Telespazio, the Italian company operating the space economy. Luca also holds a master's degree in aerospace engineering from University La Sapienza in Rome, and is a graduate of the French National Defense Procurement College and the HEC Montreal School of Management of Innovation. He's also author of more than 30 peer-reviewed publications, and a member of the International Astronautical Federation Committee and Space Security. So, Luca, thanks again for accepting our invitation. And for me, it's a great pleasure to leave the floor to you and to your speech.
Good afternoon, everybody, and really a big, big thank from my heart from to Antonio inviting me to this event today. It's really an honor and a big opportunity, and also I would like to underline that this has been possible thanks to the agreement, the cooperation agreement that the European Space Agency and the Politecnico di Bari signed a couple of years ago called ESA Lab. So under this framework, I'm happy also today to talk to you about indeed space economy. So I will provide you a small picture, let's say, of the economy of our sector, and to explain or try to provide you some hints at least of how the ESA industrial policy is trying to support the development of a sustainable space economy in Europe. So for doing that, let me share my screen. So I think that Antonio, can you confirm me that you see the screen? Very good. Okay, excellent. So I've just prepared a few slides to support my wording, and I would say that even before starting, I owe you a small and short introduction about the European Space Agency to say what is the organization for which I'm working for and that I represent in front of you today. So first of all, the European Space Agency is an intergovernmental organization. So that you must understand, it's very different from a communitarian or European Union type of agency. We are totally distinguished and independent from the EU, from the European Union. So, and this agency is composed, as you will see, by 22 member states. The history of the European Space Agency is dating back basically to the beginning of the space era. At that time, there were two organizations in Europe, ESRO and ELDO, one focusing more on the development of space research satellites, scientific satellites, and the other for European type of launchers. And eventually, these two organizations merged together in 1974, giving birth to the European Space Agency, as we know of today. And the two articles that you see mentioned in these slides basically are extracted from our convention. So that is the foundation of the agency that has been signed and ratified in 1974, and explain that the agency, the goal of the agency, is space research technology and space application, but I draw your attention to the exclusively peaceful purposes. And then there is an article, an extract from Article 7 of the Convention that is extremely relevant for the purpose of the talk of today. That is the article which explains what are the goals of the ESA industrial policy. But we will have time to enter more in details in that later in these slides. So let's move forward. Next slides. The basic operating principle. We start immediately with explaining that the agency develop ESA programs of scientific missions, satellite launchers, the full spectrum of activities in space, with one exception, that is the manned launchers. So this is the only type of activities that we do not master as a technology in Europe for today. So when we want to have our astronauts flying, they have to fly on, let's say, Russian or American rockets. But except for that, with that single exception, we are covering the full spectrum of activities. But the activities that we devise, that we imagine, we design, are actually implemented by industry. So there is a strong and
Luca, we don't hear you. Marco, do you hear Luca?
No, Antonio. I think it's a problem of its connection.
Luca, we think that there is an issue of connection because we don't hear you. We see your slide, but we don't hear your voice. Okay,
can you
Luca,
hear me now?
Now it's okay. Now we can. Now it's okay.
Okay. Sorry, I was cut. I don't know. In these days, unfortunately, we have to rely on this connection, and so bear with me. I'm trying to do my best, but let's say connection are very fluctuant. So please do not hesitate to highlight me if this breaks again. So the industry that is working with us, so our industrial teams, are led usually by a prime contractor that is a system integrator. And then the team is composed of subcontractors that are usually some small, medium enterprises providing subsystem and components of the spacecraft that we intend to set up. The composition of this consortium, industrial consortia, is based on several principles. So we have to try to put together and to really jungle with different criteria. The first one and foremost, of course, is technical quality. So we do want that our products are of technical excellence and they are matching the quality that we need. At the same time, as we have 22 member states and 22 countries that are contributing taxpayers' money to the agency, and we are using that taxpayers' money to build our spacecraft, we have to distribute this money under the forms of contracts to all the countries, to the industries of the countries that have participated to that specific mission. This means that we have to be equitable in providing a fair geographical return that reflect the contribution of those countries. So this is one of the cornerstone of the ESA, of the European Space Agency, the GeoReturn. We will talk about this later also in the presentation. And it's something that strikes an important difference between us and the European Commission. As you know, the European Commission is based, one of the pillars of the European Commission is the open and free competition. In our case, the fact that we do have an industrial policy is also an hint to you that our competition are fair, are equitable, but also have to reflect, let's say, a principle of fair return to our member states that are our stakeholders. Another important working principle of the agency is that the IPR, so the intellectual property rights that are generated in during the performance of our contracts, usually remains these rights with industry. This is, for instance, a striking difference with respect to what NASA does. In that case, NASA, the American space agency that handle, as we do, taxpayers' money, when industry working for NASA develops IPR, develops intellectual property right, this IPR rests solely in the hands of NASA. So since the government with public money has generated that IPR, in the US, this IPR remains with the public. In Europe, we have done, our member states have done a drastically different choice. And this is in the full interest of industry, because as you can imagine, IPR is the richness of a company where they generate an invention. They want to remain the owner of that IPR. It's clear that on the public remains anyway something, and this is a license to exploit that IPR at better than market condition. All in all, I would like to say and conclude these slides by saying that ESA is what we call an intelligent customer, in the sense that when we run a public procurement, this means we issue an invitation to tender and we receive our bids, and we award the bids to the winner, and then from that moment on, the contract, the development contract starts. ESA is starting to work in that moment. It is associated strongly and closely to every day, to the industry, every day, day to day in the development of the activities, advising the industry and controlling that industry is delivering according to the specification. And you must also understand that here we are not developing things that are let's say everyday technology. Here we are often at the extreme border of technology, so we are really let's say exploring uncharted territories, and this means that we have to understand when industry is facing so big issues that needs to be assisted, needs to have some waiver in contractually speaking, and when on the contrary the difficulties that the industry is facing is just minor and ordinary. For this reason, you need somebody that we refer to as an intelligent customer. So it's not only somebody that is paying, but is somebody who is also capable of understanding the technical difficulties encountered by industry. Again, on the understanding that we are really on the edge of new discovery every day. So we are a special partner for industry. We are we consider ourselves not simply the customers, but a partner. And this is this tells you a lot about our specialism, our relation. This slide is quite basic, and it evolves continuously, I must say. Today we have 22 member states, two associate member states will become three very soon, because we have Lithuania, who has recently been accepted, but still is in the process of ratification of the association agreement. So we will have very soon a third associate state. And we have cooperation also with a number of countries that belongs to the European Union. So you see that there are differences with respect to the EU. For instance, UK, who is a full member of the Space Agency, as you know, is not a member any longer of the EU, as well as Norway, as well as Switzerland. But we have among our cooperating and associate basically all the rest of the EU member states. States, including also Canada, that of course is not EU, but with whom we have a long-lasting tradition of cooperation. So it is another cooperating state of ESA. Now, few words about money. We have been talking about money. We understand where this money comes from. It's taxpayers' money from all those countries. And this is what you see here on that these slides is the budget for year 2020, so for last year. We are in the average of 6 to 7 billions of euros spent every year. And this is the repartition among the different type of programs. You see that space transportation and Earth observation are the largest share, 23% each, so mostly one quarter, followed by navigation and then technology in general terms, the exploration, human and robotic, telecommunication, and the scientific program. Next one. Next one tells you something interesting. Tells you that there is an hidden partner in this budget. The 6.69 or 68 that I've shown you in the first slide are split, let's say, among the contribution of member states. That is 73% of those 6.69 billion, representing 4.87 billion euro. You see that this 4.87 are contributed, for instance, by France, Italy, Germany. Italy, by the way, you can see here on the left-hand side, is 13.7%. So last year contributed some 665 million euro to the agency. But where does the remaining 25% comes from? And it comes from, you can see, from the European Union, EUMETSAT, and other income that are other contributing partners. So this means that almost one quarter or one fifth, more than one fifth of the budget of the agency comes from the European Union. So although, as I stressed a number of times already in the few slides that I've presented so far, we are completely independent from the European Union, we are a big partner, or the European Union is a big partner of ESA in the sense that contributes more than one fifth of its budget, of our budget every year. And they contributed for a number of activities. Remarkably, two of them are most important and the source last majority of this budget is the development of Galileo, the global navigation satellite constellation, and Copernicus, that is the Earth observation program. So these two activities are, let's say, are developed by the agency under a delegation agreement from the European Union. In particular, is the arm, is operational and executive arm, that is the European Commission. So here you see another slide talking about money. In this case, these slides help me introducing the concept that the agency is ruled by a council. Okay, that is the highest governing body of the agency. A council is the place where all decisions are taken, and in the council there is one seat for the ESA Director General, that is called the executive. You know, it's an agency, so we receive orders. And we are agent, we implement those orders. Those orders are decided by the Council, where all the 22 member states of ESA, each of them has one seat and one vote. And they take the decisions. So this Council meet at different levels. It's always the same one, but in principle, it should be held at the level of ministers. Ministers, each country has its own type of ministers that represents and talks about space. But when it comes, since, as you know, ministers, let's say, are usually very busy person, they cannot devote a lot of time to space. So they usually meet every 2 to 3 years. And last time they met in Sevilla at the end of 2019. And altogether they have decided to contribute, they have approved missions and activities of the agency for a total value of 14.5 billions of euro that basically will be implemented in the next 3 to 4 years. So this tells you that ministers meet for 2 days, usually every 2 to 3 years. Last time was in Sevilla, end of 2019. Next time will be at the end of 2022. And this is called the council at ministerial level. However, every 3 months, roughly, the council meets to take, let's say, decisions that are less important in terms of amount of budget, but still it's the as I said before, is the most important decisional body of the agency. So they rule, the council rule the life of the agency, meet every 3 months. And in this case, the configuration is that each seat is occupied by the head of the National Space Agency. And then also the council cannot talk about and decide about all the different type of programs of the agency. You see how many programs we are dealing with, so activities. So this means that it is supported in its decision making process by a number of let's say subsidiary bodies or committees that takes a specific decision on the different domains. It could be technology, earth observation, telecommunication, navigation, and etc. You can see this here. So before moving forward, now you have an idea of money that is moved by the agency in terms of contract, also of the composition and the governance. Very so you have some elements, at least some hints. Let's see how this impact and shape our national space industrial landscape. So this picture presents to you through a color code those that are considered to be the most important space industry and the space cluster in Europe. It's not big surprise that these clusters develops around university. So let's say historically the most active university in aeronautics and space, or aerospace in general terms, are those of Turin, Milan, Rome, Naples, but of course in the over the years we have also Pisa that appears, and also Palermo, and well, I keep it last, but of course not least, the host of today, that is the Politecnico di Bari, that is, I want to remind everybody, is one of the only three Politecnico kind of school that exists in Italy. And so it's not a big surprise that it's around those university that you see the development of cluster of industry. So Rome, Milan, Naples, and Turin are the largest one, but you see a dark color also around Bari. And well, we all know that Puglia is one of the most the fastest growing reality in when it comes to Italy, but I would say also at European level it ranks very well in terms of development of space capabilities, industrial space capabilities, and this is obviously thanks to the entrepreneurial spirit of the people in Puglia, but also thanks to the Politecnico di Bari that creates the conditions around. So these other slides gives you, it's taken from an activity that is part of our let's say industrial policy outfit at ESA, that is called the Observatory of Country Capabilities. And here you can see in comparison, the upper part of these slides represents Italy with respect to the lower part of these slides that represent an ESA average. So it's basically to show you how the activities of Italy are distributed along different areas. For instance, the largest one and first one, as you see, is development and production of space segment. The second one is studies and technologies and so forth and so on. But just let's focus on the first two without entering too much detail, too many details. The first block, development and production of space segment, absorbs a lot of money. As you can see, it's basically 57% for Italy of the budget. This means that 57% of the budget of Italy contributed the 600, for instance, 65 million that you have seen before. So more than half of it goes to development of space infrastructure. This means this is something that flies. That is something that has a TRL, a technology readiness level high, 8, 9. So this is something very valuable that has taken a long time, a long path to be developed. The second block, that is this represented by this 9%, is represented by very early stage type of activities. Let's say the so-called low TRL, low technology readiness level. Here we're talking between something between 1 and 4, for instance. And it shows that 9% of the Italian budget is captured by industry, by Italian industry, in terms of early stage type of studies. We don't usually you don't have the guarantee that these early studies and technologies and investment in early technology one day will fly, one day will mature until the level of TRL 8 or 9. So that all these 9% one day you will find it in this 57. But it's an indication of the ratio of the two. This is very healthy ratio. And you have to compare this with the average ratio, that is 12 versus 48. This tells you that Italy performs better with respect to the average of ESA countries in transforming TRL, low TRL activities in high TRL activities. So this means that the bridge between these two columns is very efficient when it comes to Italian industry, and this is very good. Other countries, on the contrary, invest a lot, 12% of their budget in low TRL activities, and manage to have just 48 in terms of or 49 in terms of high TRL, so flying and very valuable type of activities. So you see, in this sense, the Italian industrial system is efficient. Now, how these activities in Italy are distributed? Well, maybe not big surprise, Earth observation dominates the type of activities closely. We have a long tradition of radar satellite, Earth observation, anyway, it's really, and also processing and downstream type of activities. Exploration is also the other cornerstone of Italian space industry. In particular, we're thinking about Turin and Alenia Space, that is world leader in manufacturing, developing and manufacturing and delivering, let's say, hardware that is flying on the space station, and also is one of the success story of Italy. They are capable of exporting even to the US this kind of hardware. Let's say it is something that should never be forgotten. And third cornerstone is space transportation, also something that I'm sure you have been already talking about, is Vega and the P-80 and P-120, the two solid propulsion rocket engines. And last but not least, navigation. Also, Italy is one of the three, four countries that have been pioneering Galileo, and even before Galileo, with the cooperation on the GPS and with the US, this global navigation satellite system. And this is reflected by the distribution of these activities. So here in these slides, that, by the way, will remain with you at the end of this chat, you have the details of the type of programs that receives most or captures more of this contribution. These slides, on the contrary, give to you the name and last name, let's say, of the companies, of the Italian companies that are eating the largest part of that pie. No surprise, Thales Alenia Space Italy, followed by Avio, Leonardo, then Serco, that is a service company, as the name suggests, OHB Italia, who is a subsidiary of OHB Integrator, Capgemini, another consultant company, Altec, this is for exploration, Telespazio, Vitrosiset, these are now together because Vitrosiset has been acquired by Telespazio, at least the space part of Vitrosiset, Airbus Defence and Space Italy, let's say the footprint of Airbus Defence and Space in Italy is relatively small compared to other countries like UK, France, Spain and Germany. And then the others, last of this slide, but again, not least, and I'm not saying this because today we are virtually in Puglia, but it is very important indeed, it is Sitael. And that is an emerging actor on the space scene, more and more supported by the Italian Space Agency, the European Space Agency, and by the success also on the commercial market. A last interesting element from these slides is represented by the two pie chart in blue and violet in the bottom part of the slide that represents the share of contracts that goes to small and medium enterprise. With all the rest is going obviously to the larger system integrator, the mid-caps, laboratories, but for small and medium enterprise, you see that Italy is slightly below the average, the ESA average. We are at 5 instead of 7%. But let's say this is not a worrying trend. Let's say the small medium enterprise outfit in Italy is quite strong, very diversified. So we think it's an healthy sector, and also the trade association, the industrial association of small medium enterprises in Italy is quite active and managed to defend the interests of this category. So having said that, let's go now back to a global view, because we need also to talk about the global space economy in general. Time is really running up, so we need to go a little bit faster. Some figures, I don't want to draw you in figures, but you have to keep in mind that the injection of money in the space system, it's a fundamental figure that you have to keep in mind. Today we are at about 72 billion per year worldwide from the public sector. Again, taxpayers' money, 72 billion. So this is the input that is injected in space industry from taxpayers' money worldwide. In Europe, we are talking about more or less 11, 12 billion. Notwithstanding the general crisis, economic crisis that we have been facing in past years, this sector is steadily growing at a rate that is really impressive, plus 5%, 6%, 7% year over year. So this is important to understand that notwithstanding the crisis, governments still invest more and more in space. They believe in space, notwithstanding the fact that we are talking about peanuts, 70 billion euros worldwide per year is a drop in the ocean, is simply a drop in the ocean. But you understand that governments still believe that drop in the ocean have a leverage, as an impact effect that goes well beyond the 70 billions. And with the notion of space economy, we try to characterize and to quantify what does it mean well beyond. So on top and above of the 70 billion of public money per year, since very few years, you will see the graphic here shows 2016, we can say beginning of the 2011 maybe, we have a phenomenon of private investment. Of course, and no big surprise, this was given to birth in the Silicon Valley with billionaires coming from the dot-com type of industry who has decided to invest their own money, own fundings. But we are seeing from this graphic that this is growing steadily. And since 2006, this has increased three times. And now we have more or less 8 billion euro that are on top and above of the 72. So currently we are now at about 80 billion euros globally, where almost 10% of it is contributed by private investors. This is venture capitals, equity funds, angels, and things like that. Nevertheless, out of these 7.8 per year, only 500 millions are in Europe. And well, this is less of a good news. Let's try to see this in a global context. It is true that we are talking about really small figures for Europe. Nevertheless, they have been increasing substantially. Let's say at a rate that is even more important than the growth rate in the US. The interesting point is that, anyway, out of those figures,
Luca, sorry, we don't hear you.
Okay, let's see.
No, that is okay.
No, it's okay now? Okay.
Yeah.
Good. So I was saying that 70% of private investment are captured by the so-called 4 big, that is Virgin Galactic, OneWeb, Blue Origin, and SpaceX. So I will not elaborate who these companies are. Behind each of them, there is a billionaire, one physical person. But it's interesting to see that they are monopolizing, let's say, the private investment scenario. In Europe, things are, first of all, a different order of magnitude. We're talking about 500 million in total per year. 57 deals, so 57 investments, 70% of which provided by venture capital. But again, 70% also of these 500 were concentrated in the big five. Let's say worldwide, or in the US, you have the big four. In Europe, you have just five big investments that have captured, let's say, 70% of this investment. Anyway, it's not that bad. It's growing. I must say that until 2 years ago, there was only just one venture capital in Europe specialized and dedicated to space. Was based totally private one based in the UK. Seraphim Capital is the name, and well, obviously for historical reason, a fund that has privileged, let's say, investment in Anglo-Saxon type of companies, a small one, and that was it. Now, in the past 2 years, we have seen already additional three or four new venture capitals in Europe popping up, growing, and specialized on space. And one of these is an Italian one, and is one of the fastest growing one. So it's called the Primo Miglio, Primo Space, Gianluca Dettori, that has been also hosted by the Politecnico di Bari together with me a few weeks ago in another talk roundtable. So I'm happy to say that we see this a blossom, let's say, of these venture capitals: France, Italy, Luxembourg, of course, Germany, and the UK one. So we are not faring that bad. It's not that bad. We are growing. Still, we are lagging a little bit behind. And also another piece of information that I would like to leave to you just to reflect is that the largest number of venture capitals and deals, so investment out of the US, is in China. So in China today we have the largest part of VC, venture capital investment, in a new dimension of entrepreneurs, of new space type of entrepreneurs. I'm using these terms, new space, in a casual way. I don't know if we have time, maybe not now today, to develop more on that. New space, anyways, the convergence between the digital economy type of thinking and money and philosophy and risk appetite with space industry. That has a totally different type of approach towards risk taking and also methodologies. Just to give you an hint, and then we don't develop more because it would need a dedicated session just on new space. But when you buy your new mobile phone with the software on board, you already know that after a few weeks you will be required for an update of the software. It's part of the game, and nobody's shocked. So you know that what you're buying today is less than perfect and will be. We've received upgrade and improvement during the life. So you accept this kind of logic. Now, this kind of logic that is typical of the digital world, of the digital economy, is or would be unacceptable in space. And where, on the contrary, you cannot afford to have an update or a failure or something while you are 500 million kilometers away from Earth and your spacecraft goes in idle mode simply because the software is going in an update. So, as you can imagine, was a shock, the convergence of this media clash, not even a convergence, was a clash at the beginning. It is not by chance. Maybe we will have to talk about that in another time. But for time being, just accept the fact that most of the companies that are receiving these venture capitals and private investment belongs to this new kind, this new world, this new way of doing space. And this company, well, they are facing huge issues. One, of course, as all startups, and here one of the most important barriers, let's say, to enter in the space domain is in particular the fact that it's very difficult to convince a banker to give you a loan, to provide you, to lend you money when he does not understand your business case. When you're starting talking about satellites, new constellation, and you are competing with other potential borrower that have a business case much more understandable by the bankers. So this is one of the key issue in our industrial policy outfit that we have to deal with is education. Educate the investor community about the risk, about how we can mitigate the risk of the investors. So this is part of the role of public institutions, is also to provide the so-called anchor tenancy. This means to become the first customer of these companies that would help her to secure, at least for the beginning of their activities, a certain type of business that would help also justify their request to the bank. So there is an emergence of this public demand to serve public policies, and clearly it's not the space agency that is the customer. In this case, we are talking about governments or the European Union. So there needs to be a synergy between all these stakeholders. Continuing giving you the figures, let's say the injection of the 72 billions of public money plus the 8 billion of private investors per year, what does generate? What does bring in terms of turnover of industry? Well, here usually this is represented, the structure of the space industry is represented as a pyramid or a triangle. The top of the triangle is the smaller portion, of course, and this is what we call the upstream. The upstream part is represented by industry that is manufacturing the hardware, is building satellite, spacecraft, ground station to operate the spacecraft, components, engine, let's say this kind of hardware. And the overall turnover of these type of industry is about 25 billion euros per year. So, and so you see in these slides how this is split between launching and manufacturing. In Europe, this is roughly 9 billion out of the 25. So you see roughly we are talking about one third of the turnover is generated and captured by European companies in the upstream. But let's say 25 billion dollars or euros, sorry, per year worldwide. I say if the 80 we were talking before are a drop in the ocean, these 25 is even less. It's half of a drop in the ocean. It's nothing. So what is more interesting is to check the so-called downstream space activities. So the downstream activities are the lower part of the pyramid, of the triangle. And you can imagine that it's way bigger than the vertex, than the top of the pyramid. And here we are talking about a market that is more than 10 times larger than the upstream, because if the dimension of the upstream is in the order of 25 billion euros per year, here we are talking about 276 billion divided in the three traditional sector of the navigation, earth observation and telecom. Europe here is capturing much, let's say not much, but let's say a little bit less in proportion with respect to the other share. We are at 70 billion, so our industry captures 70 billion of turnover, but the growth rate has are really impressive. Let's say here you see that the downstream type of activities is growing more than 20% per year. And not per year, this is in the past 3 years. Anyway, this is really impressive, especially if you are thinking and keeping in mind the economic situation worldwide. Historically, the driver has been the telecommunication sector. And nowadays, we see that the big driver is the navigation one, especially because in almost all our mobile device, now it's included a receiver chipset for Galileo or GPS type of integrated application. And this is what is driving. Earth observation is, let's say, as you can see, almost a two order of magnitude smaller. And the reason is also because it is still considered an emerging market, and is very much has been historically very much related to public sector, including the security and defense type of activities. There is a lot margin. Here we can go fast. It's simply saying that overall the general crisis, the COVID-19, has affected the overall the economy. In the space sector, we have been living so far a very, very strange situation. You remember I told you that the minister met in Sevilla in December 2019. So it was just a few days before the outbreak of the COVID-19 crisis that they committed 14.5 billion for the next 3-4 years. So as you understand, the European sector has been irrorated with quite a substantial amount of money that for time being, let's say, it is less exposed to the crisis. At the same time, first, you have to understand that our contracts are usually firm and fixed price. This means that since the industry has been facing, obviously, higher cost, and the price are fixed and capped by the agency, this means that the profit margin that in space industry can do in this has been eroded substantially. And this erosion in turn means that there is less money to be invested in research and development. In turn, this means that our industry is at risk of losing critical competitiveness on the global markets. So this means that we are anticipating risks of losing market shares if at the next ministerial council that will be held at the end of 2022, our governments will not continue a similar level of support. And we know that this will not be easy, especially in the context of the pandemic that we see. However, we have good reason to and good rationale to convince our ministers to continue to support this sector. Again, it's a really a drop in the ocean. We are talking about 40,000, 42,000 jobs in the upstream in Europe. So it's half of a soccer stadium. So Audi, the car manufacturer, has 80,000 jobs. All over Europe, in space, you have 40, less, so half of just one single car manufacturer. However, the impact in terms of development of strategic competence, of innovation and knowledge is immense and huge. So my team, in particular within the agency, is tasked one of the difficult objectives is to measure the impact of every euro that is invested in ESA, in space through ESA, to measure the impact in terms of, for instance, gross domestic product increase or job creation or return in terms of tax, so the governmental income, and also in terms of innovation, so the so-called intangible or not quantifiable benefits that could be generated. So, well, we will go. We already talked about the challenges that we expect with the critical loss of manpower. If you want more information about these figures, the studies, don't forget you can connect to this site. It's considered to be the world reference in terms of measuring space economy. We developed this in cooperation with OECD, but nowadays this is really the reference. So don't hesitate. This is a snapshot of the front page that has been developed, by the way, by a company in Puglia. So last set of slides, just very quick, is to explain to you, to talk to you a little bit about industrial policy. So how ESA tried to boost and support the development of the space economy and of industry that we have been talking until now. So of 100 euro that we receive, 85 we convert in contracts to industry. We pass these contracts to industry following obviously public procurement rules, so they are open competition as much as possible, and we favor the quality, so we price and award the contract to the highest quality type of contract. At the same time, as I said before, while doing that, we have also to balance the fact that we have to be fair with respect to the contribution, since this money is coming from 22 member states. So we have to return in proportion contracts to companies of each of the participating member states. And this is what makes industrial policy very difficult. Also, not only it's a kind of geographical return, we also have to guarantee equilibrium in terms of how much of the share of the contract goes to a larger system integrator, a mid-cap or a small medium enterprise, sometimes even to reserve things for the startup that we need to develop more. So in order for doing that, for instance, we have running a business incubator program where we have more than 20 centers scattered all over Europe in, I think, more than 40 physical locations. And these centers incubates quite a substantial number of startups every year. So you see that we are really active at all across the entire spectrum of the industrial landscape. What we do, we are organized at ESA in country desk officers. So each of my colleagues is responsible for one country, and for that country acts as an advisor. So an advisor to the government in order to provide information about the development and the capabilities of industries and the performance of industry on that country. So we monitor, we observe the problems, the issues, we observe the competitive landscape, we try to understand whether the governments tend to invest too much in certain areas, leaving uncovered other areas. On the contrary, we need to have a balanced repartition of our competence, and we we strive to avoid procuring technology outside Europe. Of course, sometimes this is difficult because although the technology may be available, the market is very small, so it's difficult to convince an entrepreneur in developing a company based on a technology that has a market very small. So in that case, we are obliged to look for a provider that is outside the frontiers of Europe. But as much as possible, we try to focus and develop these capabilities, these critical technologies within Europe. And for that, we advise our member states through a number of events, meeting, bilateral meeting, but everything is built on the knowledge that we have of industry. So you understand, and you understood also from my previous slides, at least you assumes that our space systems is undergoing a very fast evolution. Industry is also integrating itself in vertical. What does it mean in vertical? It means across the entire value chain, end to end. So from the upstream to the downstream, from the development of the infrastructure, building the rocket, the satellite, down to the service provision, so and the contact with the customer. In doing that, certainly it is more competitive in the sense that the costs are streamlined and there is more synergy, but the risk of monopoly is there, and a monopolistic situation is not necessarily what we are pushing for. First of all, because this would be very difficult to provide a fair return to all our members, and also because in this case the cost, the prices go high, and there is innovation that is the engine of real competitiveness. So in this difficult scenario, we have really to change also the traditional components of the paradigm, let's say, of the industrial policy. And we have to place our agency at the crossroad of society, politics, science, and industry. So it's a very complex role, our one, and we are adding this by positioning the agency at the crossroad that I showed you before, two additional dimension of the industrial policy. That is the creation of value for society and the integration of space activities in the economy and society in general terms. So, and for this reason, we are not just any longer spending money, so becoming the R&D sponsor. We are not just a regulatory body, for instance, for the standardization or other issues related to standards and to provide a level playing field, but we are also becoming advisory to member states. We have been talking about that, but also to industry and more to investors by trying to provide institutional investors like the European Investment Bank or the fund or through the Cassini funds that has been announced recently, or the venture capitals and the private bankers, trying to provide to them our technical understanding, our technical knowledge that help them in better understanding and managing the risk. They are certainly good in assessing and managing the financial risks, but when it comes to space, they need an advisory. And here we are trying to provide and put at their disposal this type of competence in a similar way as we have been doing in the past years, providing this technical understanding and competence to our partner industry. So I will not go through all these slides, you have them, but I stop here for the moment and I open the floor for questions. Thanks for your patience.
Thanks, Luca. Many thanks for your inspiring speech. Really thanks. So now I think that I leave the floor to the participants for questions and the comments about your speech. I don't know if there are some questions, comments about your speech. Anyway, I have a question, I have a curiosity about this. First of all, Luca, I have a question about the definition of the issue, the concept of new space, especially referring to its relation with the digital economy. In other words, one of the issues that you have highlighted in your presentation is the entering into the space industry, the space economy, about of company coming from different industries, different sectors. The digital sector, the digital economy is I believe, one of the most relevant sectors that is hybridizing this kind of sector. What is your sentiment, your opinion about this relationship?
Thanks a lot for this question, Antonio, and especially I'm happy that this is coming from you, that you have been publishing a book on the space economy and this kind of issues, so you are highly qualified and it's a pleasure discussing this matter with you. Now, having said that, yes, I briefly mentioned the fact that space economy, new space, sorry, it's usually referred to as the convergence of these two philosophy, and certainly the question of the risk taking exemplified by the question of the software update already tells a lot. But I have been trying to understand a little bit better why, so what is the real motivation for a billionaire of the dot-com industry to invest in space. And I mean, I've been interviewing a lot of people in this respect, and I received very funny replies, including also the fact, and that is true, by the way, the fact that most of these billionaires were also passionate by science fiction and Star Trek in their youth. That is certainly true, and maybe it's also part of the motivation, and that's a part of the legend that is created around this history. But more recently, I think that I found some hints that are more consistent with the reality. And the fact that, you know, that a few months ago, for instance, Microsoft teamed up with the SpaceX and the new constellation SpaceLink with the consortium Azure Space. And that was an eye-opener for me, in the sense that we have again the convergence of a giant like Microsoft with a new space company. In parallel, a few months before, we had an announcement of the other constellation for internet, Kuiper, from Amazon. So again, another giant of the web that was investing in space. And again, space is represented for them by mega constellation of small spacecraft to provide internet to their users. But so in this case, these satellites are very small satellites, are satellites very inexpensive and built in a large series. Imagine that SpaceX injects in orbits up to 60 of these satellites almost per week now. They want to arrive to reach a level of 3,000, 4,000. I heard also 30,000satellites, spacecraft constellation. And this means that the space commodity, it costs nothing. I mean, we are not talking about the expensive satellite that are used for, I don't know, deep, high performance Earth observation or deep space exploration or the Mars exploration. This will cost today and will continue to cost hundreds of millions or billions even. But in parallel to that, now we have satellites that are just commodities. So for these big investors and big players in the internet community, the space is become an inexpensive part of the infrastructure, and not the most important one, by the way, because it is to be seen in conjunction also with the terrestrial 5G and the fibers. So the important thing for these players is to have internet arriving everywhere around the globe, and possibly to provide internet through a proprietary network. And this is a big difference, because as of today, let's say nobody could claim to be the owner of the infrastructure, the internet infrastructure. But now once your signal is passing through one of these networks, well, there is a question of sovereignty. There is a question of who is controlling my signal. And not just that, for security reason or sovereignty reason, but also for the fact that you are captured in an environment. Let me give you an example that I also used a few weeks ago, is the example of Apple, that of course is developing its infrastructure, so the mobile phones, so the iPhone for instance, but this is not the most important part of the business. Actually, the most important part of the business is the capacity that through that infrastructure, they have created an environment where app developer can develop their business and sell their application. And this is the most important part of the business. So in, to make the parallel with space, I see that the commodity that is now, that now is, could be considered all this mass of satellites or small spacecraft, relatively inexpensive, is there to provide seamless access to environments provided by Amazon or Microsoft or other players, which allows business to be developed. So space is just almost an invisible part of this infrastructure enabling a business. And this is for me the reason why these investors, these big players from the dot-com has started to invest in space.
Many thanks, Luca, for clarifying this interplay between these two different economies that are experiencing a number of similarities, a number of relationships, a number of links. I see that there is a question from Professor Vito Albino. Please, Professor, ask your comments, your question.
Hi, Luca. Thank you for your interesting presentation. I have just a very simple and complex question at the same time. As China is becoming a great player, a big player in this space economy, do you think that in the next future we should have a kind of differentiation of business? I mean, US companies, European companies, China companies specialized in different fields, or do you think that we should have a strong competition in each field?
Unfortunately, I think, so first of all, good afternoon, Vito. Thanks for this question. Unfortunately, I think that, not unfortunately, but that's the projection that we see is that we are going towards fierce competition. So fierce competition, 360 degrees. So there would be, China is going to develop its own space station, its own moon base, its own rover for the moon. And there is, let's say, no sign of opening, let's say, on the US side with respect to that. So we see really a division in blocks. A little bit, we are back to the logic of the Cold War and the strategic competition that sounded to us and looked to us a bit now history, back something old in history. But now it's back again, and it's pushing a lot, by the way, also a revamp of spending in military space, in the militarization of space. So, and this is, I have not mentioned that before in the space economy part, but spending in the military will be the major voice of space economy in the next years to come. We are seeing clearly this arriving. Space has been considered a sanctuary for, let's say, for the past 60 years. There are four or five international treaties that rules the peaceful use of outer space. Even in the first slide, they mentioned that ESA has for peaceful purposes only. Nevertheless, we see that now in US, France, Italy, I don't know, every day I read it on the newspapers that there is the establishment of a new Space Force Command.
Yeah. I agree with you. Unfortunately, the International Space Station has been just a beautiful step, but the future is not, is a little bit darker. Thank you. Thanks, Luca.
I see that we have also our rector, Francesco Cupertino, with us. So now I will leave the floor to him for conclusion of the seminar.
Antonio, you spotted me. Can you hear me, Antonio?
Yes. Okay, very well.
Hi, Luca. Sorry for missing the start of your speech, but I managed to follow almost all of it, and it's always a pleasure to listen to the complexity of opportunities of this sector of space economy, the complexity of the opportunities that the relation with the European Space Agency, opportunities that could be good for universities, but also for our students and for the companies, not just companies used to work in this field, but you know, as a space has no borders by definition, you know, also the space economy sectors tends to be a no border area in the field of economy, of business opportunities. Of course, it's a pleasure to welcome all of you to this this event. I was listening at the question at the end of your speech, and being the quantity and the complexity of such opportunities, what do you think could be the role of universities in, you know, in translating such opportunities into something that could be at the reach of our local companies? You know, it's not just something you are not used to be related to space sectors, but also the vision, the point of view of small and medium enterprises, you know, sometimes is very far maybe from the consciousness of what kind of opportunity they could have. What could be done, according to you, in order to, you know, to empower this this transfer of knowledge about the opportunities and the results eventually that could be reached having a relation with the European Space Agency or at a large with the research centers working in this area?
First of all, thanks a lot for your intervention, and really highly honored that you took your time to spend some minutes with us to this evening. It's always a pleasure to meet you, Francesco, by the way. I think that Politecnico di Bari is faring very, very well in this respect. And again, I'm very proud to be part of your team more and more often, because the fact that I am part of your team is already a part of the answer to your question, in the sense that you are asking how can we favor the exchange of information about the opportunities to the new generation of students. Well, by inviting people like me, but I think I'm happy that I'm not alone, because I know that you are doing a series of lectures with not people like me, but well above my level, let's say, with really the guru, the Gotha of space. This is the way to go, because you have to inspire people by bringing astronauts, by bringing professors or even engineers with hands-on experience that have spent their life in this domain, to transfer their knowledge, their enthusiasm for this, because it's a sector where I'm happy to say that, let's say, I'm basically surrounded by geeks, by people that loves what they do. They are not almost nobody of my colleagues in this family that is the space industry family is there by chance. Some of them, they are always dreamt of working in this domain. So it's something where there is a huge amount of feelings, of personal commitment, and it's very easy to have these people around the table and to transmit this passion to your students. So this is a general level. Second point is there is a question that space can be used, because it has a fascination since always, can be used to attract new generation to STEM. And this is something that, I mean, you know better than anybody else how difficult it is, especially in sectors like engineering or space engineering, where, for instance, female representation, women representation is lower than expected. So I think that there is a way also through space to rebalance or to attract, to fascinate more young generation, and in particular girls and women to our domain. A third aspect is beyond the diversity, and here you mentioned the SMEs, so let's say you also have set up tools like the DigiLab. Now, the DigiLab, I had the pleasure of introducing the work last year of DigiLab. It's exactly that kind of laboratory where you develop entrepreneurship spirit, where you mix up and you complement the technological, let's say, an engineering development of the curriculum with the business and application side. Because this is what historically we have seen, traditionally, we have brilliant engineers with fantastic ideas, but no idea about how to make this invention becoming innovation. And I'm distinguishing the two things: invention, the inventor, innovation. When you make an impact on business, this is innovation. If it remains just a good idea, it's a good idea. When it becomes business, it's a different way. And DigiLab, in my opinion, is a good way to accompany students in that direction. So you are doing well, all along.
Thank you, Luca. I'm not asking if you can record you, because we already did. So I will.
too bad, too late.
thank you for your word. Thank you for your speech and your availability. Marco, I don't know if we want to recall our next event. Otherwise, I thank everybody for attending this inspiring speech, and I hope to see you soon next in the at our next next event. I always hope as soon as possible in person, in presence at Politecnico here in Bari.
Okay, Francesco, thanks. I really want to thank Luca for his kind availability, and I have to say a very interesting and clear talk. I'm not an expert of space economy, but I really find the talk very clear. So thanks, Luca.
Grazie.
After more than 1 year of pandemic, it's not easy to keep the attention of students. We are overexposed to this virtual mode. So I thank you for the effort you put into it, and for your time. And the next talk will be on the next Tuesday, and will be given by Marco Molina. So he's a managing director for space sales and products in CTEL. So as you say, CTEL is a very nice player in Apulian region.
I don't it is, Marco is one of the best engineers we have in Italy. So I mean, good choice.
Yeah, he will talk about space economy from a private enterprise perspective. So it's a natural continuation of your talk. So thanks again, Luca, and hope to see all of you to the next event. Thanks for your time.
Thanks a lot. Grazie. Buonasera.
Buonasera. Ciao.
Thanks. Bye bye.
Ciao a tutti.